Well, welcome again, class, to our lecture number four. Today is April 13, 2020, and we have one of our foremost vice-chancellors, Vice-Chancellor of Taisholari University of Education, Ijagun, Ogun State, Nigeria, Professor Abayomi A. Arigbabu, who will run us through constructing and determining the validity and reliability of achievement tests. But who is Professor Arigbabu? Professor Arigbabu, as I said, is Vice-Chancellor of Taisholari University of Education. He holds a BSc Education Mathematics, MSc Mathematics, and PhD in Mathematics, Science and Technology, MST, with specialization in Mathematics Education. Professor Arigbabu has been involved in MST education and teacher preparations for over 3 decades. He is a fellow of the Mathematics Association of Nigeria. His research acumen is emphasized in his contributions to many international journals and a host of national / local journals and books. He is an external examiner to a number of universities in and a consultant to some national and international organizations like Learn Africa PLC, Pearson Educational Services in UK, United Nations Population Fund, UNFPA, and the World Bank. It's also a reviewer to many reputable national and international journals, particularly those cited in the index of ICER and Scopus. My pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, to hand us all over to Professor Arigbabu. You have the floor, sir, Vice Chancellor.
Morning, class.
Well, it's a pleasure to be around this point to give my lecture, and I want to thank all participants and the facilitator general, Professor Okebukola. I've been introduced by Professor Abayomi Adelaide Arigbabu. I'm from this university, Taisholari University of Education. That is the entrance university. It's a compact but aesthetically pleasing university, and I would like to just take you in, but I'm actually not going to take you in physically, so that is the entrance to the university. I'm putting this for a particular reason, because as a younger student in those days, they teach us something about motivation when you want to start a lecture, so it's sort of motivation. The topic we are discussing is on the time of the reliability of achievement tests. And normally, you set objectives at the beginning of lectures, and that's what I have. At the end of this presentation, we should know about achievement tests and then describe the basic steps to construct achievement tests. More than the when validity of achievement test, reliability of achievement test, and how to determine the validity and the reliability of this test. What achievement test? What are achievement tests? That's a test that is designed to assess the achievement in the subject with regard to the pre-established object. And that was, achievement tests are designed to provide information on how well students have learned they were taught. When I showed you the entrance of into the university, I will ask some questions. Just taking it as if that was the lecture that I've given, I would then ask some questions. Then I have those questions, it will take me into the issue of I will be able to tell whether the questions I will be asking you are like. I've told you about my university. I've told you about my university. Please answer some questions. I want to ask which university is called LASU, or what is the LASU? That is the first question. Question number two. What is the student population of LASU? What is the student population of LASU? Question number three. How many programs do we run in LASU? Let's leave it there. I'll come back to that very shortly. Now, we have standardized achievement tests in various subject areas. And in the such tests are usually examples like ACEITSE that we are in the Stanford Achievement Test, MAT, CFTB, that's California Achievement Test, and so on and so forth. We also have achievement with standard achievement tests in Nigeria. Well, we can move. I just want to find out. Can you give an example of standard achievement tests in Nigeria? Anybody?
Jam
is not a test. That's the name of an organization. Joint Regions and Matriculation Board.
Excellent. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
UTME, sir.
Good. Thank you very much. Because those standardized tests are such that you'll be able to use this as some parameters. So, for instance, show that's parameters that will be set, and it is against this one that the student's performance will be judged. Now, I want to, because the difficult area is about validity and reliability. We're talking about validity and reliability. We are talking about validity and reliability of an instrument. Okay? If it's a study you want to do, then you use an instrument. If it is a test you give to students in the class, which is a human test, you might be using an instrument in a particular test. Now, you can see the design that I have now. How do you design an achievement test? The first stage is what we call the planning stage. That is planning test. You have to plan test. You don't just give them a plan. And that planning will require some other things that you take. You know, you have to know what we call test blueprint or what they call table of specification. The focus of this particular lecture will not be on the details of how to do it, but I'm sure in some other classes probably will have done this or you can read about it. You know, that's basically what you have to do. So you have taught students a particular thing or a particular course. You want to set questions. You want to show that you are not setting questions, just focusing on some aspects of your course or getting some aspect. You will be sure that the questions are done in such a way that you give you attention to complete aspect of it, to all the parameters you have. Also, you want to be sure that you have covered all the various topics you have taught in that course. The table of specification is like this one, I'm going to test this on recall, I'm going to test this on synthesis analysis, and so on. I'm going to make sure that I ask questions on this topic, that question that might be brought and so forth. So that is what planning entails. And after the planning, you go to the preliminary, you have that, which was preliminary draft. That is like a technical one. Okay? And at the preliminary draft stage, you carry out the item writing, test items, and then you edit, you look at it, juggle it here and there, and so on. And then you pre-try. In other words, it's like you are testing something. When we started this at the beginning of this presentation, Professor was trying to be sure that I was ready, and I was saying, okay, it's like we are doing what you call testing. And I'm sure those who are very familiar with that type of thing in when the organized parties in Nigeria, you hear hello to a tweet, hello to a tweet, hello, can you hear me? testing, you know, something like that. So that's what I call hello to a tweet. So you do the pre-tryout. After the pre-tryout, you do the real tryout. That's when you now actually carry out the test. And then you do item analysis. All these things I'm just saying like this, they require some in-depth things. So, but that's not the focus of this particular presentation. So item analysis, some calculations will even come in, and I don't want to actually bore you with formula and so on. And then you now go to the final, this is the test I want to administer. So, but when you now want to administer this, you can see that in the slide, on this slide here, validity and liability fell down. So we are not sure that the test that I have designed, is it valid? Is it reliable? Remember, I asked you some questions the other time. So those questions, as the first question was, what does the acronym LASU stand for? Or what's the meaning of LASU? If I ask you now, except for some people who probably are familiar with Zerenia in Nigeria, particularly if I ask some of my friends from Nigeria, they don't know what LASU is, but maybe there is even another acronym that looks like that. So they will give me an answer that is not right. Also, I ask about the population. What is the student population of LASU? Does anybody know? Nobody. And how many programs do we have in LASU? Nobody knows. So you can see we are now gradually going to validity. Validity, you have achievement test now. If you look at the next slide, you have an achievement test. Fine. Now, is it measuring what you measure? Is it appropriate? Reliability. Will they produce consistent result? Is it a dependable test? The questions I ask you about LASU, the first question, second question, third question, can you now tell whether they are valid or not? Because I told you, I'm not questioning about like you. There was nowhere in the presentation I was talking about LASU that I mentioned the population of students in LASU. There was no way I mentioned the programs that you have. So, when we talk about validity, you can meet the point by what you ask. Probably asking a ES1 student, giving a question to answer, and then you end up coming up with some observation and see that this person or some members that say, oh, I don't know anything, and so on. That bit comes in. So, at times you have a test that was valid, but it's not reliable. So if you give a test to a set of students and you have the test is not actually valid, it might be liable. Whereas it is not valid. What am I saying? If you give them questions that they cannot answer or questions that are beyond them or whatever, they score zero and so on. If you administer it again, it will still be zero. It will be consistent. You consistently, so you can still write a question to be an achievement test. Might be valid and yet it will not be reliable. So it's very important when you design an achievement test to ensure that you take care of validity and reliability. And what is validity? An achievement test is said to be valid if it measures what it purports to measure, that is, what is set out to measure. What is the focus? Is it doing exactly what it should do? If you are using an instrument that is for measuring it, you want to use it to measure height or whatever. You're using thermometer to measure to measure the
okay.
so you know, and so on like that. So you can, I mean, that gives you an idea of what validity is. We are talking about the appropriateness of the test or of the attribute from the test. So that's why I gave the example. It is probably the most important characteristic of a test. But validity asks about four major types of validity. We have what we call phase validity. We have criterion-related validity. That one is actually broken into two, predictive and concurrent. Now, we have construct validity, and then we also have content validity. Now, phase validity, just as the name as it implies, it's just like phase value. If you look at, let me just use a real life example. Some of us, we are getting so strong that when people see them, they just say, are you Professor Okebukola's son or something? Because you can see that the semblance is so close. And that's how I can actually, so this validity is, on the face of it, the face value of that achievement test, is it the face value? That's phase validity. And then we talk about the criteria of validity. That one, the predictive one, is talking about the extent to which the test can predict your force. Okay? Based on this, okay, this person is likely to become a good medical doctor. You can actually base future prediction on what that test is. And then concurrent reliability is a relationship between the test and the other measures. Probably you have given this particular test, I mean, this particular test, you actually stick the relationships. I draw a correlation between construct validity. That is the extent of agreement with the theoretical concept. Let's just say, for instance, that there is a particular theory that any student that is taught, maybe they have breakfast. That when students are taught, let's say there's that particular theory by Professor Okebukola, that when students are taught without breakfast, they always do very well. They always perform very well. And then you now carry out a study and it confirms it. That is agreement with theory. So construct validity is clearly to establish the extent of agreement with theoretical concept. When people do tests, I've just mentioned this, because some of us, when we do research, and we know that what people have been saying is that male students perform better than female students in science. Male students perform better. You now carry out your own, female students now perform better than, you now say, how can my own test be different? No, I just have to, maybe I should change the male to female, and then change the female to male. No. That's actually not right. It's better for you to report whatever you get. So I just say that by the side. But also, validity is to actually establish the extent of agreement with a theoretical concept. And then, of course, we have a content validity, which measures the which test items measure what it was designed for. You want to see the extent to which the test item that you have measures exactly what you want it to measure. Now, there are some factors that actually affect validity of instrument. They affect, they weaken the validity of instrument. Some of it, because that was just like the questions I gave you the other time. If you use expressions that are too difficult for test participants, and of course they don't actually understand what you are asking. So definitely, when they now give responses, and these responses are actually not appropriate, then you will now be basing your judgment on it that students are not very well. I remember in those days when I was in the university, I was offering a course. And the question was asked, and that question, a particular vocabulary was used. I've never seen it before. So I now raised up my hand and I asked the lecturer, I said, "Sir, does it mean so, 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 and so?" I said, "If I tell you what it means, then I've told you the answer. That's, it's like I'm answering the question for you." So it's just because of that word I couldn't. So when later on I understood that particular word, I realized that I was too difficult, complex sentence structures. Some people can write sentences that there will be no full stop until probably they get to the end of the page, and they continue to write to the extent that the person will get confused using all sorts of expressions. And also, now can affect validity. Also, including what I told you about LASU. Yes, I've told you about my university, but I now ask you what the population of students was, and then what's how many programs. So, if you ask students when you didn't teach students, it can affect the validity. So, if you use unclear and confusing test items, it will affect it. Vague test direction. Even when you give instruction on the question, how many questions should we answer? Complete answer to any four questions gives you maximum score or maximum. So you don't just say any four questions. There are so many people just want to be different, and then you complete the same at the end of the day. Also, inconsistent and biased scoring. Then to people who mark without having marking scheme, no marking guide, and so on and so forth. These are some of the things. If you now score based on an inconsistent and biased scoring procedure, you are then to give the grade to students to vary depending on your mood and so on. So, of course, misconduct and malpractices. also can affect the validity of achievement test. Now I go to reliability of achievement test. That is talking about the extent to which it consistently measures what it is supposed to measure. That was why I gave the example that even when it's not valid and you still administer it, it might still be reliable because those who have been on get their or whatever they get. So that's not so it says may be valid but not and reliable. So consistency is at here. The reliability, how reliable it is, how consistent it is. It is the degree to which a test produces consistent results whenever it is administered over and over. Of course, reliability, legally, what you find the most that you talk about. Four types of reliability. Some talk about five. This is like the fifth one, just an amalgam of some of the words. We have what we call the equivalency, and we have what we call the stability or test resistance, and then we have internal consistency, and then we have character reliability. I'll take them one after the other. The equivalence reliability refers to how well two tests measure identical concept at an identical level of difficulty. At an identical level of difficulty. So the key word essentially is that two tests that probably have the same number of items, they have the same number of items, the same levels are being measured, it has the same structure, the same difficulty level, and the same pattern of administration, scoring, and interpretation. You see, let me just digress a bit. Some of us, when we conduct study, we want to find out maybe performance of a particular student, performance in physics is better than their performance in mathematics. And then you are comparing apple and oranges. If you want to know whether students have done well somewhere, you want to look at that. You are using the same instrument to measure that. In other words, if you construct a test, because students are always making that during their project, they will construct it. They will go to get the student's performance or student result in a particular class. Maybe mathematics in school A. They will now go to school that collect the students' results also. It will be first time mathematics exam, first time mathematics exam, and then you compare. And you ask the students in school A are better than students in school B. You are not comparing them with, are they use the school certificate examination for that year, correct, which is the standardized exam,
yes.
Drawn by WAEC. And that is the same examination. So you can now be comparing. Otherwise, we'll be comparing apples to oranges. So that's how the equivalence. Then let's talk about stability or test stability. This is the extent to which major instruments agree over time. Well, what this one suggests is that there is a bit of, you administer something, wait a little bit, and then administer again. And check how it actually tallies. So increased similarity implies increased stability or consistency of tests. In other words, when you see that if there is high similarity in what you have, stability, then it shows that there is high consistency and then reliability. And computer is also computed by operating the course of the two tests obtained at different periods. You conduct it four times. You have to discuss, you conduct it at another time, you have discuss. You do a simple correlation and see how it goes. But the major shortcoming of the test, retest reliability, or what we call the stability reliability, is that it's determining the appropriate interval between the test. In other words, how soon or how late should the second test be carried out. So if you do it, if the interval is too short, maybe after 1 week, students may still remember the earlier responses, hence unreasonably high coefficients of stability will be obtained. See that those who did well last time are also doing well and so on and so. It might actually be because they still remember the responses they gave. And if the interval is too long, and then there might be some other intervening variables, and maturation may increase the performance, and hence unreasonably low reliability. What I'm saying is, I want to say maturation. In other words, after, even just like this course now, some of you are already taking this course. By the time you finish this course, let's say somebody administered the test about 2 weeks ago. If you finish this course and then they now administer the same test, some of those items, probably they are part of what you have taught here. It's definitely, it will affect your performance and you do better than what you did before. So that's a major shortcoming of this one. Internal consistency reliability is the measure of how well tests or procedure assess the same attribute. This one deals with reliability of a single test taken at one time. And it measures the level of consistency among items of the test, which then with the whole test. In other words, the level of consistency among the items of the test with the entire test. And there are three forms of this one. We have what we call the split half. We have the Pudar Richardson 20 and 21, and we have the Kronbach alpha. As soon as possible, I don't want to do a lot of calculation in this course. I think there will be time probably during the weekend when you'll be able to do a lot of this calculation. But we'll do a bit. We'll do a bit because the time here will not be enough. And I know that the level of mathematical background of all of us are very so. So that give a lot of time for that. So what is the result for split half? For the split half, what we do is that you have an item. That item, let's say it's a 50 item test. You split it into two. In other words, you have 25-25, odd and even, that is one on the first one, let's say test A, now one there, two on test B, three on test A again, four on test A, so you do that to divide into two. So when you do it, you now correlate this on both. In other words, you know, you want to give it to students to answer. If you don't need to split it to two, you are giving it to students, they will do everything. When you are now doing your report, you split this thing into two, and then you say, okay, before 25 on this side and 25 on that side, and you now do correlation. So when you do correlation, you now apply what we call the Spearman-Brown correlation formula, determining the ability of the entire test. That's the formula. The formula is RT is equal to 2RSH over 1 plus RSH. What we have here is the RT is actually, the TR is standing for the total test. It's standing for the total test. Why the subscript of a RSH is actually stand for the split up. So RT is equal to 2 multiplied by the reliability. That is the R you get. The R you get for this up multiplied by 2 and divided by 1 plus that R. The reliability of the total test. So the exercise I have here, which you do at your own time, if the split half liability of a certain achievement test is 0.75, use Spearman-Brown formula to estimate the reliability of the 50 item test. So we can do that at our own time. And now we have the Richardson 20 and 21. Now this one is good for Daiko to closely score test. These are tests that we have just two options. We have either yes or no, one or two, or true or false, and so on. So this particular Kudarishati is actually very good for it. Here, I have an example. Suppose you have a 40-item test with mean calculated to be 5 and standard deviation to be 3, calculate the KR20 reliability estimate. Actually, you see, you have KR20, KR21. What do we mean here? Now, the KR20 is used when the items have varying difficulty, while the KR21 is used when items are about the same level of difficulty. We have the formula. The formula for the KR20, that is n over n minus 1 into 1 minus summation pq over variance. Variance actually is the square of side deviation. So, and for the KR21, it's n over n minus 1 into 1 minus m into n minus n all over n multiplied by the variance. And you see, the end there is for the number of, that is sample size of the test. Variance is for the BR, so variance of the test. P is the proportion of people passing the item. Q, the proportion of people feeding the item. And that's particular sign, sigma sign, is actually the one for summation. So, like I said, we may have time to actually practice how to carry this. a good example of how this one is done. Now, of course, we have come back some alpha. Professor Kola mentioned that one last week. And like I said, the way he did it in the class, you think that it is just something that is as easy as that. It is not difficult, but you need to understand how it is actually carried out, particularly using SPSS. So, but the way he did it, you know, as a experienced maybe professor, you know, you just think that it's easy as that. But let us give you an idea. This one is always better when the choices are more than two. When the choices are more than two, you have, maybe you have strongly agree, disagree, strongly disagree. Most people don't want to use, we don't want to use undecided. You know, you have to decide. So when you put on undecided, people just run that. Let me just put on undecided. You have to decide. Is it that you agree or you don't decide? I mean, just undecided in the question, I'm going to ask you a question. So, I'm just going to sense. So, the combat alpha is actually like a generalization of K-Atrains. So, the formula is alpha equals N multiplied by C bar over V bar plus N1 by C bar. Where the N there is the number of items, the C bar is the average, is, you know, is the average. Like that, we are taking the average of covariance between the items, item pairs. And then the V is the average covariance. This application here, we can actually do it all these ones during the weekend. So you can, but anyway, you may not bother yourself with all these calculations. So here I've summarized what Professor Bikola did on that day, so that you remember. You know, he was just moving his mouse here and there, and people didn't know what he was doing. But I actually put it in a way you will see. You know, he told you the first thing, when you have the data, you analyze. Then when you click analyze, the thing will go down, you see the drop down. Now you run down that particular drop down and go and pick scale. When you pick scale, then scale will also show you something, and then you go and pick reliability analysis. And then when you click that, you now say you transfer your items. You remember on that day, you showed us how to transfer, to move them to the other set. So you transfer your items, the default is usually alpha, that's what we're going to. And then you have the statistics, you click the statistics, in that box, you select item, you select scale, if item deleted. He explained it on that day, that at times when you get your reliability, you see that if you delete some items, reliability can go. Oh, and then that can improve it, and then you can say, let me delete this item and so on. So, and then you choose correction in the item box, and then click on continue, and then you click on open. So, if you have this one beside you, when you open your SPSS and you have your data there, you can then follow the way I've given the structure, you know, and you just do it like a robot. Just go on like that, you get to the end, and you get the answer.
Wonderful.
Now we have the inter-rater. The inter-rater reliability, which is also called scorer rater or inter-scorer. You know, to make the extent of agreement of two or more individuals rating of a test or video. In other words, it's like, let me see, something similar to this is when you have this America's Got Talent or some of these shows they have, and you have a lot of people, they will just go and say, okay, I give you a yes, I give you a no, I give you something like that. So, not the level of agreement of two or more ratings, two or more individuals, so something like that. So, this UN test was absolutely subjective. You can see the example I gave you. I mean, somebody would dance in front of you or would say, well, for me, I agree, I give you a yes. And you give me what? If you ask them what, everybody will tell you why. So, it's subjective. So the source of subjectivity might be due to the variety of that or a single matter over time disagreeing with the score of a single test. What I would say is that if you put panelists, I mean, myself, I'm here, Professor Okebukola is here, Professor Lainka is there, Professor Fabarole, and so on, Professor Neme Briggs, and you say, okay, these students, they are here. Give your assessment. We look at you, and then we just give our marks. Well, because about five of us, and the marks will be great. That's what we do in Italy. When you interview for people, you say, Professor, Mr. Sanzo, you are welcome to this interview, you answer the question, and people will give you marks. When you leave, we now start saying, okay, Professor, what did you give for this study? So that's like inter-rater and what you call inter-scorer. So, and then it can also be by a single individual. In other words, you rate over a period of time. The first time you do it, you keep the scores that you have, then you rate another time and so on. So that's still in that. This obtained by correlating the scores of two or more raters. In other words, we now correlate and then we'll see what we get. What are the factors that can weaken the reliability? Reliability. I think that's an error there. So reliability, I'll actually correct it before I send the final one to so the testing environment. When was doing this lecture, said that it went or something. So if the environment that students are writing test, if the environment is not conducive, it can affect the reliability of that test. So there are other things that can actually light, sound, and so on and so on and so on and so forth. Also, guessing or chance error. We tell you where something is 50-50. Oh, it's true, of course. When people are guessing, definitely that will affect the reliability of that test. Transitory instabilities. Let's say you just hear a bang. You hear the sound of a gun somewhere. Everybody will just be jittery and so on. It can actually affect, or maybe you are writing your pen. Suddenly stop writing in the test. You start sweating under air conditioner, all sorts of things. So all these things can affect reliability. Length of test also can affect the reliability. So items selection, too many interdependent items also lower reliability. Reliability of the scorer himself, the mood. If somebody has just fought with his wife or the husband, and then it's not marking, just say, so you can just transfer the aggression and that will. So difficulty value of the items. If they are too difficult, they may not do well. If they are too easy, everybody may be getting 100. I saw the result of that. So you can see some element of reliability there. So discriminative value also is out clear at the item. That is item discrimination. Then test instruction, if it is clear and unambiguous, that one can also affect reliability. I've come to the end. What have we done here? We have been able to explain what achievement tests are. We have been able to describe the basic steps in constructing achievement tests. We have explained validity of achievement tests. We have explained reliability of achievement tests. We have illustrated briefly how to determine the validity of achievement tests. And we have also illustrated how to determine the reliability of achievement tests. I said that my target has been achieved, and I think so. I want to say that as postgraduate students, as PhD students, when you go for lectures, by the time you leave that lecture, you realize that what they have given you, it may take you another 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, to unravel everything and get. So you have just mentioned all this and you think everything is clear, but you get home and you see that you require to actually do a lot on your own. You have whetted your appetite and I feel that you'll be able to do more on your own. But of course, I will allow for questions and answers. I want to thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. This is just awesome. We'd like to thank Professor Arigbabu for the excellent presentation. This is just mind-blowing. He has been very, very meticulous. He has been very detailed. He has been very simple in his presentation of this topic, albeit a few hitches with regard to the connectivity, but very brilliant lecture. So I can see that Sukomi Gbeleyi, you have your hand up already. You have the floor to ask the first question. Gbeleyi.
Thank you very much, sir. I want to specifically thank Professor Arigbabu for this virtual launch. It's been very interesting.
Heavy launch. It's a three-course launch. Yes, you're right.
Yes. If time will permit me, I have just three. So my first question is that, you see, I've been talking about sizes, you see, and the world particularly for now, I'm looking at whether the numbers of people who have contacted COVID-19 is increasing or decreasing.
So, Sukomi, yes, sir. That word is not contact, it's contract.
You contract a design. Thank you very much.
Go ahead.
So either is it increasing or decreasing? So my first question is reliability test on callback alpha sensitive to sample size? That's the first question. The second question, is it necessary to establish content validity again if I'm doing a study in another country? Then the last question, if I'm to conduct a validity and reliability test on COVID-19 questionnaire on vaccines recommended by this group, how will I go about it if they are not connected to the internet? Thank you, sir.
Sorry, third question again.
I said, if I'm to conduct reliability and validity test on COVID-19, using COVID-19 questionnaire on vaccines recommended by this group, or the ERTs group, how do I go about it if those people that I'm giving to are not connected to the internet? Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Let me answer that. Talking about reliability, I think you are talking about whether content reliability is necessary again. And I can almost mark the two questions, those last two questions together. You see, when you conduct tests, the test you conduct is actually based on a particular sample that you have used for your test. If a test has been conducted in America and they get a result, you don't just base it on that and say that is the situation in all cases. Because so many things can actually account for your own situation. So, and that's why we do, some people will do what we call reliability and validity of instruments, even when they say, okay, there is an maybe ICANN instrument for attitude and so on and so forth like that. So we still go ahead and conduct our own local, that's like you are doing what I call suitability in your own environment. You want to say, is this instrument suitable? In fact, when you take those items at times, you will end up saying, maybe in my own situation, we have to remove this item. Or maybe in this my own situation, people might not understand this particular word. I give examples at times. I remember the first time when I traveled outside Nigeria, and there are some of the things that we are used to here, the way we call them. You know, you say you want nylon bag, you know. In some places, they don't call it nylon, they call it plastic bag. So and you say, so my friends said, I want nylon bag. And they were looking at him, nylon bag? Or the bag? We don't have. And the guy said, this is nylon bag. He said, no, plastic bag, my friend. No, plastic bag. No. So items, even the items you have there, you might need to change some words to let it be aligned with what you use in your own setting. And that's why the ability and value. So for any instrument you have, so and I'm very happy that Professor Okunbola took you through. Let's say you take a particular instrument, it has been used somewhere and you already have the values established. Come back over, it's already established. You have to do it in your own situation. In your own situation. I remember I wrote a paper for psychological reports, and they said, okay, no. I should break it into two papers. First of all, do reliability and validity of this instrument. I was talking about mathematics, efficacy, beliefs, and so on and so forth. So you now apply the instrument. Instead of just taking the instrument and just apply it like that, and so I said, no, I mentioned it there that I did. They said, you want a full paper on that instrument itself, that is reliability and validity, or what you call the psychometric properties of that particular instrument. And then you go ahead and apply it. That's another. So they ended up making me have two papers from it. So that's the type of thing. So you have to use that local peculiarities is very important. You cannot just take an instrument and import it and then you start using it in a new environment. I think I answered the question. I don't know if there is any. Have I answered your question?
Yeah.
The third one.
Okay.
He said he has marked them. Yeah. Sukomi, I mean, sent to the
VC. Yeah, you talk about it.
Sukomi said he has answered, he has bundled everything. Sukomi, send your this thing by email at time. Let's have some other people.
Thank you, sir.
Asking a question.
Michael Ige, sir.
Michael, just a minute. Michael Ige, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. I want to appreciate our prof for taking us through that question. But I have a question I want him to clarify, sir. When he spoke about standardization in his early slide, when we do projects, we pick questions from WAEC past questions and JAMB past questions. Do we still need to do validity and reliability of that test question? Thank you. That's my question, sir.
Very good question.
Good. Now, by the time you are using a WAEC question and you now take one from here, take one from that, it has affected because you are not using, if you are using it exactly the way it is, then you say, okay, this is standardized. By the time you now do it on your own, you have already tampered with whatever standard and whatever is there. You have to use it exactly the way it is. But if you are just the one selecting, then you now have to do your own, run the validity and the ability of that particular instrument, because you are now getting a new instrument, not the exact question the way it is by WAEC for that particular examination. So, which is still similar to what the earlier person also asked.
Thank you very much, sir. Who is next?
Thank you, sir.
Adolf.
Adolf, yes, you have the floor, Adolf. Yes, Adolf.
Yes, thank you, Professor. Yes, I have two questions.
Okay.
The first is, what can be the limit value of alpha, Rombach alpha, and chi R 20 and chi R 21? The second question is, where we can now situate nomological validity, convergent and discriminant validity among those kind of validity that have been cited here?
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Very good. Very good question. Yes.
Thank you. Well, the first question you asked.
Yes.
The first question you asked about the alpha value. For compact alpha, we always want to come that is more than 0.7.
Yeah.
0.7 and above are considered good enough for test. When you do a test and then you have a value that is 0.4, 0.3, and so on and so forth, definitely it's not good enough. So 0.7 and above is good enough. So then you ask the other question on what.
So other types of validities like discriminant, you know, reliability, discriminant, and all of that that
yes.
you mentioned. Yeah.
Yes, you know, I said even you have some people even yeah. I mean maybe breaking down some of these things further and further and further. But what is most important is that when you talk about reliability, that the way I've looked at be able to position whatever you are talking about in here, because all the others, in a particular book, you see, you talk about equivalency and make match equivalency and the stability, and they get what they call equivalency stability. When Professor Kipola was presenting the other time, he was talking about types of research, and he said, some people would just say this type of research, this type, depending on the type of classification they are using. But you can position whatever reliability you are talking about, you can position them in all these four basic types of ability that I've mentioned here. Criminal, and so on and so forth.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I know that for... Thank you very much for the lecture, sir. I know that for reliability, if you pick any one of them, it could be fine to test your instrument. But for validity, am I supposed to go through from first validity to the last one for an instrument, or I just pick one or two or three? That is question one. However, sir, I'd like you to clarify more on predictive and construct validity. Then, when you were talking about reliability, you said something about interdependent items. I like an example or two in that regard. Thank you, sir.
Well, now on the issue of which validity that you use, the point is that if you decide that all that will be okay for you, maybe between you and your supervisor or you alone, and you can convince that your supervisor, or you can convince us, or you can convince, if it's a journal article, you can convince them that the type of validity you use is appropriate, is okay, then there is no problem. But it's not a matter of you do base validity, you do construct, you do content, you do, so you should be able, it's like carrying out tests generally, like I tell students, when you want to write a project, your PhD thesis or your master's, and you now take a topic that you cannot finish in the next 4 years or 5 years, like Professor So are you going to wait for another 4 years before you get your degree? So you are the one to decide how you go about this thing, and then it is something that is acceptable. And of course, you have the opportunity to convince people that I decided to use face validity because of so and so reason. Or I decided to use this validity so because of so. Some will be so clear that this is just what you have to use. So, and the other question, I think you asked about
predictive and custom validity, sir.
Yes. Now, predictive, like you said, you can use it to actually predict future performance. It's like I'm saying that, okay, if I give this test, any student that is able to do this very well now, you can then say, okay, this is likely to be a mathematician, or it's likely to be. So that is the extent of that type of test to actually use it to predict future performance. So in the case of the construct, Abby, Yes, the construct validity, like I said, there is already a construct. There is a theory. There is a theory on ground that, okay, Nigerians are rich people. I just use that again. So that is a theory that has been established by somebody. And then you now carry out a study which agrees with that. So construct validity is done to establish the extent of agreement of your instrument with what is established, what is already on ground, or what is regularly believed.
So that will be the end of our wonderful lesson for today. I'm going to give the floor to two people, and that will be it. That's Bugoma to Wadu. You have the floor. I will take you later. Bugoma, you have the floor. Bugoma.
Okay, thank you to Professor Arigbabu for this interesting presentation. So my question is like a clarification question. I would ask this achievement, are they applicable for qualitative analysis and quantitative analysis, or they are only specific for quantitative analysis? Thank you.
Well, achievement tests, when you do achievement tests for qualitative, I think you are talking about qualitative and quantitative.
Yes.
Qualitative and quantitative.
Yes.
It depends on the type of test, it depends on what you set out to achieve. If what you set out to achieve will require you constructing tests, then definitely you can use it. Don't forget that the issue of a number of participants in a test, it depends on also what we have research where you can have only one participant, we have research where you can have so many. So depending on what you actually want to carry, that would determine the type of instrument you use. So it's not limited to that type of research.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
The last hand that I wanted to mention that we took before. It's also from the University of Bukhari Pro School. He raised his hand just now. I see him again now. Okay, I'm not able to. So, on that note, I'd like us to appreciate Professor Abayomi Arigbabu, the Vice Chancellor of Taisholari University of Education. I'd like all of us to appreciate him. We are very lucky in this class. Very, very lucky. Even the students of Taisholari University of Education cannot see the advisor or come chief to their class like this. So you can see that our Vice Chancellor, we have brought him to come and teach us, a whole Vice Chancellor of the first University of Education in Nigeria. How lucky can we be? We have also the Vice Chancellor of the University of Ibadan. That's the first university in the whole of Nigeria. First university in Nigeria. First university to be teaching you. I think it's going to be on in a couple of days. That's Professor Duola Yinka. We are very, very lucky here. We're also very lucky to have Deputy Vice Chancellor from Osun State University, Professor Nicola Lisbon, and all of them. So this is just awesome. So we are delighted. We are very happy with the presentation. It's very clear. If I learned a lot, even more than I think you all. So Just give me a minute. Professor Abani, can you see what we have on the plaque? Can you please read it and present to him?
Yes. 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 Lagos State University, Africa Center of Innovative and Transformative STEAM Education, World Bank supported. This is to certify that Abayomi Arigbabu facilitated courses E811 and ECN112, April 18th, 2020.
All right, so thank you very much. Let's give a round of applause. We look forward to. By the way, I'm sure you have seen the. We are upgrading our site. I don't know how many of you have seen it, but let me just show you very briefly. I have 2 more minutes, so until tomorrow. Thank you. I wish you a very, very nice day.
That's the VC of the lodge.
All right, thank you all very much. So that's bye-bye. See you tomorrow.
Okay.